So today, this particular lecture will talk a little bit about crystallography. Of course, this particular thing which I am presenting here, normally we do not teach in first year. So all this particular portion which I am giving is generally a part of the basic solid state physics course, which is a part of MSc course, not really the first year course. So till whatever I covered last time, you know, that was more or less what you used to do in first year with some modifications. Okay, so when we start about the crystal structure, the first idea that we introduce is what we call as a Bravias lattice. So this is something which is inherent to any crystallography thing that we talk is a Bravias lattice. Now, a few statements which I want to make. See, people always get confused. So many times we use a language which can further confuse people. When we are talking about Bravias lattice, it's not a crystal. Crystal is something different about which I'll talk later. It's just a geometrical arrangement of points. Okay, just a geometrical arrangement of points. A Bravias lattice is always infinite. We don't talk about finite lattices. Okay, of course, a crystal can be finite, and a crystal is always finite. Okay, that thing is, as we said, we'll discuss later. Now, this arrangement can be one-dimensional, two-dimensional, three-dimensional, depending upon situation. So, as I said, as far as Bravias lattice is concerned, this is just a set of points. It is a pattern of points which fill the entire space which obeys certain conditions. That's what basically is the idea, that any infinite arrangement of points, even any infinite regular arrangement of points, may not form a Bravias lattice. So that's what I'm going to give some examples, what we actually mean by a Bravias lattice. And this is something very, very important, because the entire solid state physics is based on these concepts. In fact, if you start with a Zeeman's book, the first statement that Zeeman makes, that the study of physics of solids would have been impossible had the ideal structure for every material would not have been a perfectly crystalline lattice. So we start from as I said last time also, we always want to start with the simplest problem, and unfortunately or fortunately, infinite lattice happens to be the simplest problem. So let's accept that the Bravias lattice is a set of points which is infinite and obeys certain conditions. Now let's look at what are those conditions. It's an infinite array of discrete points with an arrangement that appears exactly identical from whichever point the array is viewed. So it might be one-dimensional, two-dimensional, or three-dimensional. Basically, the idea is that if you are sitting on a particular point, and of course you are aware of the environment, you know about your x direction, y direction, and z direction, so you know where you are located. And if I close your eyes and put you to some other point of the Bravias lattice, you should not be able to find out whether you are at the original point or you have moved. Okay? It means essentially the environment has to be exactly identical. Each point should be exactly identically placed. So if the regular arrangement, infinite arrangement, obeys this particular condition, then only we'll call it a Bravias lattice. Now this is, for example, a two-dimensional simple square lattice. This is the arrangement of points. Of course, I cannot draw infinite set of points on this particular thing. So we have to sort of accept that I have drawn only a few of the points. And these points keep on continuing like this, infinity in this particular direction, infinity in this particular direction, infinity in this particular direction, infinity in this particular direction. This is purely a square lattice. If, for example, if I move from this particular point, if suppose I am in this particular point, and let's suppose this is x direction and this is y direction, then I'll find that around x direction, there is a point, let's suppose this distance is a, we find another point at a distance of a. If I move along the y direction, again I find a distance of a, another point. If I move along I plus j direction, I find at a point at a distance of root 2a. All right. Now, if I move from this particular point to this particular point, exactly identical situation will happen. If you move on the right hand side, you will find a point at a. If you move upwards, you will find a point at an a. If you move along this particular direction, you will find a point at distance of root 2a. So this environment is exactly identical for these points. That's why we call this set of arrangement as a Bravias lattice. Now, there is a 2D centered Bravias lattice, for example. Here, in addition to these two points, there is also a point at the center. Originally, it may appear as if this point is differently located from this particular point, because this particular points are at the corner of the square, while this particular point is at the center of the square. But that's not really so, because if you draw another square, this point which was at the center would now appear to be the corner of this square, and this point which was originally appeared to be at the corner of the square now will appear at the center of the square. So my condition is still obeyed, that if you are moving from this particular point to this particular point, environment is exactly identical. You cannot say looking on a point whether you are sitting at the center of a square or you are sitting at the corner of a square. It depends on how you want to look at it. You can always call that I am sitting at the center, or you can always call that I am sitting at the corner. So this also is an arrangement of points which we can call as a two-dimensional Bravias lattice. Now this is an example of a non-Bravias lattice. Okay, here we have 2 points which are located like this. This is also infinite arrangement. Okay, this is also a regular arrangement, symmetrical arrangement. However, this does not form a Bravias lattice. The reason is that if I move from this particular point to this particular point, the environment becomes different. For example, if I am sitting on this particular point and if I move along this particular direction, which is let's say minus I minus j, then I will find, let's suppose this small distance is x, I will find a point at a distance of x. But if I am sitting on this particular point, then at distance of x, I will not find a point. Therefore, this particular point and this particular point are not identically located. Though this point and this point and this point, all these are identically located. These points are also identically located. But when I am looking at the lattice in its entirety, then I do not find that each point is identically located. This point and this point have different environments. Therefore, this is an example where you have infinite lattice, but this is not a Bravias lattice. Okay. This is another example of what we call as a honeycomb structure, which is basically hexagons which are fitting with each other. This is also a non-Bravias lattice. Okay. Because if you are sitting on this particular point, here at a distance of A, for example, let's suppose this is A, you will find a point here. But if you move along this particular direction, you will not find another point at a distance of A. So this is also a non-Bravias lattice. Okay. In fact, you will find out that as I move from this particular point to this particular point, the environment keeps on getting rotated. Okay. But nevertheless, because the environment is different for each particular point, this does not form a Bravias lattice. So what is the key thing is that for a Bravias lattice, all the points must be identically located. Okay. I should not be able to tell if I move from one point to any other point, whether I am at the same point or I have moved to a different point. And remember, this has to be infinite. There is an alternate definition which can be shown that they are exactly identical definition. This is what I'll call is a more useful definition, more quantitative definition. And this definition I have given for a 3-dimension. It can always be accordingly reduced to 1-dimension or 2-dimension. Okay, I will not show that they are equivalent. Normally it's not shown, but you can always visualize and see that these two definitions are equivalent. So this is using vectors. So let us suppose we have 3 different vectors, A, B, C, which are not in the same plane. Now I make a translation vector, which I am calling as a T, which is N1 times A plus N2 times B plus N3 times C, where N1, N2, N3 are integers, positive, negative, or 0. Okay. I keep on varying the value of N1, N2, N3, starting from, let's say, 0, 0, 0, which leads me to the origin. Okay, then take 1, 0, 0, 2, 0, 0, whatever it is, take all possible values of that, and then you will generate at a Bravias lattice. Okay, these 3 vectors, A, B, C vectors, are generally called primitive vectors of a lattice. So each lattice is different, each Bravias lattice, okay, I mean, let's be clear, when I am saying many times in lattice, probably I will mean a Bravias lattice. Only in the beginning I had to give you an example of a non-Bravias lattice. But most of the time when we say lattice, generally we mean Bravias lattice. So, you know, I mean, that's what I say, you know, while speaking many times we use things which are not 100% correct, but, you know, so long we understand it, it's all right. Okay. So a 3D Bravias lattice can also be defined as a set of all points, the position vectors of which are given by this particular equation. Here N1, N2, N3 are integers, positive, negative, or 0. If we are talking of 2-dimension, then instead of 3 vectors, I will have only 2 vectors. If I am talking of 1-dimension, then I will have only 1 vector. The vectors A, B, C are not in the same plane and are called primitive vectors of the lattice. They are used to generate infinite set of points forming the Bravias lattice. Alright? Now, let's go to 3-dimensional lattices, which are the simplest 3-dimensional Bravias lattice is what we call as a simple cubic lattice. Of course, we have to assume that these lines which have been drawn are not there. Actually, what are there are only points. Okay, it's only for our convenience, it's only for our drawing convenience that I have drawn these particular lines. Okay, and these particular points which I have shown here are moving infinitely. You know, they have infinite set of points in all the 3 directions, or rather all the 6 directions, plus x minus x, plus y minus y, plus z minus z. Alright, you can verify yourself that if I use the primitive vectors, A is equal to A times I, B is equal to A times J and C is equal to A times K, this will generate this particular lattice. Okay, so you take just linear combination of these vectors like I have given you in the previous example. Okay, so you will be able to generate the entire lattice, or for that matter you look at any particular lattice point. Okay, you will always be finding that that can be represented, the position vector of that can always be represented as a linear combination of these three vectors n1a plus n2b plus n3c. So primitive vectors of a simple cubic lattice is what I have given below. Now this is what is called a body centered cubic lattice, in which, I mean, I generally always take the example of a room while teaching because this is comparatively easier to visualize. Three-dimensional structures become a little more difficult. And see, let's assume that we are sitting in a room which is a cubical room. So all the corners of this particular room are centered, and in addition to that, there is a point at the center also. Now looking like what we have said for square lattice, this particular point which is at the center can also be looked as a corner of another cube. Therefore, this particular point is identically located. So it should not appear that, okay, this point has a different environment from this particular point, because this is at corner and this is at the center, because using this particular center and the center of the neighboring cube, okay, you can form another cube for which this particular point will be at the corner. Now what I have given here is, of course, let me also tell you, there are multiple ways of having primitive vectors. There are number of ways in which you can define the primitive vectors for the same lattice. Normally we choose a particular convention. Now when we take for BCC lattice, conventionally we take these as the primitive vectors. Of course, you can take slightly different things also. You can take A is equal to AI, B is equal to AJ, and C is equal to A by 2 I plus J plus K. But you know, normally we try to take a more symmetrical set. So this is the way we take the primitive vectors, which is A is equal to A by 2 minus I plus J plus K. So when you are talking of the first vector, the first one is negative. When you are talking of the second vector, the second one is negative. When I am talking of third vector, it's the third one which is negative. So if this is your origin, this particular corner, okay, you are not looking at this particular point, you are looking at one particular vector which is joining the center of the neighboring cube. There is another which is joining at the center of the cube which is bottom below. Okay, these are generally taken as the primitive vectors of a body centered cubic lattice. Of course, you can always, I mean, I always give this an exercise to the students, that you can show that any point, for example, this particular point or this particular point or this particular point, can always be taken as a linear combination of these vectors. So there is absolutely no ambiguity about that. The next lattice that we talk, I'm giving example of cubical lattices because they are much more useful and are much more simpler also. So this is a face-centered cubic lattice, in which you do not have a point at the center of the cube, but you have points at the centers of all the faces. So you have this particular face, you have four faces here, five faces, six faces. Okay, all these faces are centered. So this face, there is one particular point at the center. This face, there is one particular point at the center. This face, there is one particular point at the center. This particular face, there is a point at the center. So this is what we call as a face-centered cubic lattice. Probably all of you know these things. And for this, the primitive vectors are defined like that. A by 2, J plus K, it means you are, suppose this is my origin, this is my X direction, this is my Y direction. So you go half the distance here, then half the distance above. So it is the point which is joining this face center. Then A by 2, I plus K, I plus J was this particular point here. I plus K will be this particular point here. J plus K, so you'll have a point which is this face center. So the vectors which are joining these things, these are the primitive vectors of a face-centered cubic lattice. And again, you can see that every point of this particular Bravias lattice, of this particular, what we call as a unit cell, can be represented as a linear combination of these vectors. Now, after defining a Bravias lattice, the next important thing that we discuss is the concept of a basis. That's the way always solid state physicists look. And sometimes, that some other people from different area have a slightly different way of looking at it. But physics people always want to define a crystal structure on the basis of a lattice and a basis. Now, basis is something what you actually put on these particular points. Now, there are three reasons why we used and introduced the concept of a basis. The first is that, like the examples which I have given you, there could be many set of points which are regular, which are infinite, but they do not form a Bravias lattice. Now, we can always take more than one particular point and convert a non-Bravias lattice into a Bravias lattice. So many times we do that. We convert a non-Bravias lattice to a Bravias lattice by using a basis. So I start with a Bravias lattice, Then at this particular point of this particular lattice, I introduce, let's say, 2 points or 3 points or n number of points. So my basis becomes a set of points, and you have to place exactly identically on each point. What is most important is the symmetry, and what we call is the translation symmetry here. So if I have chosen one particular basis, on all the lattice points, I have to put the basis exactly in an identical fashion. Okay. So we use it to convert a non-Bravais lattice into Bravais lattice. That's the first use of this particular thing. Second use, which we normally do in crystallography, especially for cubic lattices, that we convert one Bravais lattice to another Bravais lattice. Originally also we had to have a Bravais lattice, okay, but we convert into a simpler Bravais lattice, okay, by using a basis. And that's what is generally done in crystallography. When we are talking about BCC lattice, generally it's regarded as a simple cubic lattice with 2 points basis. When we are doing a FCC, generally it's regarded as simple cubic lattice with 4 points basis. All right, so this is generally, as I said, is done in crystallography. So many times a Bravais lattice is converted into a simpler Bravais lattice, okay, by using the concept of basis. And third, the most important thing is that you can put an atom or a set of atoms on each point of the lattice to generate what we call as an ideal infinite crystal. An ideal crystal is always infinite. Okay, a practical crystal, for example, is never perfect. Okay, it can never be infinite. But as we always say that in physics, we always start with the simplest problem. So we start assuming that my lattice is infinite, my crystal is infinite, and the effect of surface and effect of the finiteness is taken into consideration by putting appropriate boundary conditions. That's what we do later. All right, or taking this as a perturbation, depending on what type of problem you're talking. Okay. So in principle, I mean, if you look at the Kittes book, which is one of the most reputed books on solid state physics, that's what he writes, a very nice equation, that Bravais lattice plus basis is equal to crystal. So in order to generate a crystal, you have to have a Bravais lattice, you have to define what is Bravais lattice, you have to define what is your basis. Okay. Once these two are defined, then you generate what we call as a crystal. So for example, I had taken this as a non-Bravais lattice. Now what I could do, I can imagine this particular set of points as an infinite set of points, okay, where you ignore the second point. Okay, and say that is my Bravais lattice, and then I say that on each point of this particular Bravais lattice, I put 2 points like this on each point. So I generate another pattern, which is also infinite pattern, which does not form a Bravais lattice. Okay, so starting from a Bravais lattice, I could generate this particular regular arrangement of atoms, okay, by putting 2 points basis. Remember, on all the points, I am putting exactly the 5 points exactly in identical fashion. That's what is necessary, that the points must be put exactly in identical fashion. Okay, so this forms now, this non-Bravais lattice can be thought of as a Bravais lattice with 2 points basis. Similarly, if you look at that honeycomb structure, which I had discussed earlier, then you can see that if I take these 2 points as one set of point, these 2 points as one set of point, these 2 points as one set of points, okay, this actually forms what we call as a simple hexagonal lattice. So remember, even in the honeycomb structure, if I had another point here, that would actually have formed the lattice. Okay, only because that particular point was absent, this was not forming a Bravais lattice. But if I take 2 points basis, then you can see that this particular structure gets converted into hexagon with center point, and this actually turns out to be Bravais lattice. So I can take a two-dimensional hexagonal Bravais lattice and put 2 points which are oriented like this on each of these particular points, then you'll be able to generate a honeycomb structure which is not a Bravais lattice. So this is one of the examples where we convert a non-Bravais lattice to a Bravais lattice by taking different number of points in the basis. Then, as I mentioned just now, a BCC lattice can be thought of as a simple cubic lattice with 2 points basis. You start with a particular simple cubic lattice. Assume that at each point, you are having 1 point here and 1 point at the center of the room. Okay? Then you will essentially be able to generate a BCC lattice. BCC lattice on its own was a Bravais lattice. Okay? Simple cubic lattice on its own is a Bravais lattice. But many times, especially because, I mean, I'm not talking about unit cell concept, because it's much more simpler to talk in terms of drawing a cube. So it's much simpler to talk of unit vectors, I, j, k, and a, b, c, which are just simple, mutually perpendicular to each other. While in these cases, you know, these vectors may not be mutually perpendicular to each other. So it's much more simpler to talk in terms of simple cubic lattice rather than talking in terms of body-centered cubic or face-centered cubic. So body-centered cubic lattice can always be thought that at each point of, start with a simple cubic lattice, at each point you put 2 points now, one point at the origin, another point at the body center, which is a by 2 I plus a plus k. Okay, you will generate a body-centered cubic lattice. Similarly, a face-centered cubic lattice can be generated from a simple cubic by putting 4 points in a basis. Okay, you start with this particular point, you put one particular point there, you put one particular point which is at this face center, another particular point at this face center, another particular point at this face center. Keep on doing exactly for all the points, you will generate a face-centered cubic lattice. So, a face-centered cubic lattice can be thought as a simple cubic lattice with 4 points basis. Now, in order to create a crystal, for example, many times we say iron at room temperature is a BCC material. I mean, this is again a sort of a short way of saying, when we say that iron has a BCC structure, it means it has a BCC lattice. If you take a BCC lattice and on each point you put one atom of iron, then you will generate a BCC structure. Then you will generate the crystal structure of iron. Okay. So, in order to say that much thing, we expect people to understand, so say iron crystallizes in BCC structure. Effectively, it means that I start with a BCC Bravias lattice and on each point I put one atom of iron. Then I will get the iron structure. Sodium chloride, I mean this is, I mean I remember once I had an argument with some of the school teachers when, sodium chloride is always, actually I should have brought that particular thing also, is considered as FCC lattice. I mean if sodium and chlorine would have been identical, then this would have been simple cubic lattice. But you know, sodium and chlorine are not identical. And remember in basis, in our Bravias lattice, that's the first condition that all points have to be identical. Now if you look only at the sodium points, okay, forget about chlorine points, then you will find that sodium form a FCC lattice. Or you look only at the chlorine points, okay, chlorine will form only an FCC lattice. So sodium chloride actually has a FCC lattice in which you put two atoms basis, one of sodium, sodium ion you can say, or chlorine ion, okay, in exactly identical fashion, and you will generate a sodium chloride structure. Similarly, cesium chloride has a simple cubic lattice. I mean, I'm not sure whether you're familiar with cesium chloride structure. You have all corners are, let's suppose, cesium, then chlorine is at the body center. Now, if cesium and chlorine would have been identical, this would have been BCC lattice, but they are not identical. Okay, so actually, this is a simple cubic lattice with two ions basis, one with cesium, another with chlorine. So you put one cesium ion at the origin and one chlorine ion at A by 2 I plus A plus K, or the other way, it makes no difference. Similarly, diamond, which is a little more complicated structure, is also an FCC lattice with two atoms basis. You put two carbon atoms, one at the origin and another at a distance of A by 4, not A by 2, A by 4 I plus A plus K. So actually in diamond, if you divide this particular room into 8 smaller cubes, so you take A by 2, okay, so this particular room will be divided into 8 cubes, smaller cubes, side of which will be A by 2. Then you will find alternate of these are centered. So if this is centered, the neighboring will not be centered, that will be centered, this will not be centered. So alternate of these cubes will be centered. So that's what is a diamond structure. Now, next thing that I want to talk is about the planes. So that's something which is very, very important for us to go into the crystallography. When you're talking of the lattice, remember we are not talking about the lattice. Okay? Then you can draw a very large number of planes inside this particular lattice. When I draw planes, okay, there are two conditions which has to be set. A plane must contain a lattice point. Okay, I cannot draw a plane just here, okay, where there is no lattice point. So whenever I am talking of planes in crystallography, this particular plane must contain lattice points. It must pass through lattice point. Okay, otherwise, this plane, I will not regard this as a plane. If no point is passing on that particular plane, okay, let's say between this wall and this wall, these are parallel walls, there could be infinite number of planes which are parallel to each other. But I will not accept those planes until a lattice point passes through that particular plane. So whenever I am talking of distance between planes, okay, that's, let's be clear that these planes are those in which there is a lattice point passing. Now, by symmetry, which we have argued out, because all points have to be identical in a Bravias lattice, if a particular plane is passing through a particular lattice point, a parallel plane must pass through all the lattice points. A parallel or the same plane, either the same plane or a parallel plane must pass through any other lattice point. So if there is a plane which is like this, going like this, which is passing through this point, okay, through this particular point also there is a plane which should pass through that, which is parallel to it. Because all points are exactly identically located. There is no difference between this point and that point. They are perfectly symmetrically located. So if there is a plane passing through this point, a parallel plane must pass through all the other lattice points. So this is the example which I have given. All my examples are two-dimensional because they are rather easy to draw. For example, there is one set of planes which are red, another set of planes which are blue, third planes which are purple. So these are various planes which have been drawn through the lattice. And remember, see, for example, this is one plane, this is another set of planes, okay, this is another set of planes, okay. They are all differently oriented with respect to each other, okay, but they are always passing through a lattice point, and a parallel plane must pass through the lattice point. For example, if you are taking here, there must be a plane which must pass through this particular point, which of course will pass through this particular point. If I am looking at this particular plane, through this particular point also a parallel plane must pass. So through every lattice point, a parallel plane will pass. Now, next thing that we talk, because it is very important for us to characterize these planes, and for that we use what we call as Miller indices. Miller indices is the way to quantify a particular plane, give a particular name, a characteristic number to a particular plane. So that's what we call Miller indices. Miller indices are used to identify or characterize a particular set of parallel planes. Remember, when I say a one particular plane, let's say 100 plane or 111 plane, it always represents a set of parallel planes. Okay, so I am saying 100 plane, it means not a particular plane, but all set of parallel planes will be 100. Okay, so it's used to characterize a set of parallel planes, and this is the way we generate, I will give you an example. This is the way we generate a particular Miller indices for a set of planes. First, we take the intercept of this particular plane along the three primitive directions. Okay. Sometimes I don't take primitive, but I take conventional directions. Like for example, cubic lattices, I generally take along the x, y, z direction, and not necessarily those primitive vectors which I have given for BCC and FCC, which happen to be a little more complex. Okay, so we take intercepts of one of the planes, you take any plane of the set, along a suitable set of axes and express in terms of lattice constants. Okay, so you express what is the intercept of this particular thing, okay, in terms of lattice constant. Lattice constant, ABC, whatever are in general. Take reciprocal, inverse of that numbers, then multiply by a suitable constant so that there is no common factor nor there is any fraction. Then the set of planes that we get, we put into a small bracket, and that's called Miller indices of that particular plane. So I'm just giving one particular example, and this a lattice is, okay, I think I probably missed that particular transparency. There are in general 14 Bravias lattices, which are 7 crystal systems, okay, these in 3-dimension. So this, I'm not listing that, you know, you look at any solid state physics, they will give different type of lattices. A lattice is depending upon the symmetry, the more symmetrical the lattice becomes, okay, we classify that as a separate lattice. So let us suppose we take some arbitrary lattice, and let's suppose this is one plane, which I'm drawing as a triangle, but this is supposed to be entire plane, infinite plane. So this plane cuts this particular, let's call this is one axis, I am not calling x, y, z axis, because these in general for a lattice need not be even mutually perpendicular to each other, mutually normal to each other. Okay. So this is suppose one of the directions, and this plane intercepts here. Okay. And let us suppose this is the lattice constant, which in general can be different for different lattice in different directions. So this actually intercepts, if we call this particular intercept A, this intercepts at 2A. So the intercept here is 2A. Because this intercept here, this is supposed to be A. This distance is supposed to be A. So this intercept along A direction is 2A. Then we look at the intercept along the B direction, which is this particular direction. I think I have called this as B. Doesn't matter. Okay. I've drawn my figure incorrectly, but let's call this particular direction as B. So intercept here is 3B. But let's take this as B. So if I take this as B, the intercept is 3 times B. So I write intercept as 3 times B. If I take this as C, this intercept is 4 times C. So I take the intercept 4C. Then I forget about ABC because I express this in terms of the constants ABC. So I just take the numbers 2, 3, 4 and I take inverse of those numbers. So this becomes 1 upon 2, 1 upon 3, 1 upon 4. Okay. Now these are fractions. So I have to multiply by a suitable number so that eventually they become integers. Okay. Now if you take 3 into 6, if you take 12, if I multiply by 12, okay, so 12 divided by 2 is become 6, 12 divided by 3 is become 4, so this should be 4, okay, and this is 4, 3, so it should be 6, 4, 3, so I'll make a correction, so it should be 6, 4, 3 plane, all right, so this is the way we define Miller indices. Now in a simple cubic plane, 100 plane refers to a set of planes which are parallel to yz axis. A 110 plane in a simple cubic lattice is something like this, which divides this particular room into two. A 111 plane is something like this. Okay, here the intercepts are all AAA in all the three directions. Now, many times we have to give indices for directions. We have to talk of specific direction. A electron is moving in this particular direction in a crystal lattice, for example, in the crystal. And when we want to define the direction, the notations are comparatively very simple. You just express the direction in terms of the ABC vectors, which we have already defined. They can be primitive or they can be conventional. Okay, then just write in a square bracket, and that's what is UVW. So UVW direction means UA plus VB plus WC. That's what is the direction. Many times we have to refer to a set of parallel planes. For example, if you are talking of cubic lattice, whatever is the property along this particular plane, you expect the same property along this particular direction, because what I am calling is the x-axis, you could have decided to call that as the y-axis. Okay, you could have called this particular axis as z-axis. So this plane, as far as certain properties are concerned, okay, may be exactly identically located to this particular plane. Similarly, directions, if I am talking of this particular direction, let's say along x-axis, okay, a particular property, let's say band structure, okay, whatever is the band structure along this particular direction has to be identical along this particular direction, because they are exactly symmetrically located. So many times we are not looking at a specific plane or a specific direction, but looking at set of identically placed planes or identically placed directions. Okay, then I use a different type of bracket. So a set of equivalent planes I put into curly brackets. If I say HKL plane, for example, if I write for cubic lattices in curly bracket 100 plane, it will mean 100, 010, 001. All the three sets of planes combined together can be represented by HKL in a curly bracket. Similarly, if I am talking of equivalent directions, then I put into angular bracket. If I say 100 directions equivalent, put in curly bracket, it means it will include 100, it will include 010, it will include 001, because as far as the properties are concerned, in all the three directions, the properties are expected to be identical. So therefore, we just put them into the angular brackets. So it depends again on the type of lattice, type of problem that you want to describe. You may use these notations to generalize that I am not talking with specifically 100 plane, but I am talking of 100 planes and all its equivalent planes which go by symmetry. Now, here I have written that in three dimension you have total 14 Bravias lattice types, which are classified into 7 crystal systems. And I mean, of course, you can say the triclinic is the most general lattice, but on the other hand, in the triclinic lattice, as it becomes more and more symmetrical, we classify into different lattice. In principle, there are 6 lattice constants, which are A, B, C, and the angles, alpha, beta, gamma. I will skip those things because that you can see into any standard solid state physics book. Now, let me talk about X-ray diffraction, which is the Bragg's law, one of the most famous laws, which I think people study even in high school. But I always find that, you know, people don't really understand it so well. So that's the reason I always put certain emphasis on this particular thing and take it from this particular point. So here what we are talking, we are dividing the lattice into various planes, which I have already said we can divide. Okay, Miller indices of which I can always put it. Okay, so a lattice is divided into a set of various sets of planes. All right, now let's suppose X-ray is incident on a set of planes and its glancing angle is theta. So let's again be clear that this glancing angle is different from angle of incidence. Angle of incidence is 90 minus theta. The angle of incidence when calculated in the optics is always from the normal, while here in X-rays, the glancing angle is always calculated from the plane. Okay, so this is the theta is the glancing angle. Then I will get Bragg reflection, I will get a constructive interference, provided two conditions are satisfied. For that particular set of planes, the angle of incidence must be equal to angle of reflection. So this must also take off at the same angle from which is same as the glancing angle. This is one condition. This is what we call condition of a specular reflection, okay? Which essentially like a mirror-like reflection. So if I am putting a plane like this here, a set of planes like this, a light beam comes here, it gets reflected in this particular direction. Similarly, the X-ray comes here, if at all, it's going to get diffracted. It has to get diffracted only in this particular direction. But the difference between normal reflection and the X-ray reflection, we call it sometimes reflection, but it actually means diffraction, is that if a light beam is incident, it will always get reflected, provided this mirror is properly coated. But here, if the X-ray beam is incident here, it may or may not get diffracted in this particular direction because it has to satisfy another condition, that 2d sin theta is equal to l lambda should also be satisfied. If only both the conditions are satisfied, then only I will get X-ray beam diffracted in that particular direction. So if I have just put a set of planes and I put, I let the X-ray be incident on that, it's not definite that I will get a diffracted beam making an angle theta with this like thing. Okay, it may or it may not happen. It will happen only if the second condition 2d sin theta is equal to l lambda also gets satisfied. That's what is very, very important. Both the conditions have to be simultaneously satisfied. Also, just satisfaction of 2d sin theta is equal to l lambda is not enough. It does not mean that you will get in any direction if 2d sin theta is equal to l lambda is satisfied. If it is satisfied, you will always get beam only in such a direction which essentially involves a normal reflection, a specular reflection. So these two conditions have to be satisfied together. Now this is what I wanted to say. This is again, as I said, you know, normally I have found that people, the students don't understand the Bragg's law so well. If you use a single crystal and a monochromatic beam of X-rays, okay, crystal means a normal crystal, you know, many times have polycrystals, you know, in which you have multiple small crystallites which are all oriented with respect to each other. Normally, most of the materials that you see are polycrystalline. Then, in this particular crystal, I mean, whatever is the lattice type. Okay, let me also mention this particular thing. Bragg reflection talks only of the reflection from lattice points. It does not talk about the basis. The effect of basis is always to be accounted separately. In fact, this gives sometimes a wrong picture to the students, because they see, because we always show the FCC. So they think that atom is so small, tiny here, and there is another atom tiny here, and it's, you know, connected by a bar. No, that's not a correct picture. I mean, a much better picture is that this atom is spherical and that another atom is spherical and they touch each other. That's a much better picture. But in Bragg reflection, every time you talk of only the point, so people generally are confused. So I always clarify, Bragg reflection talks only of the condition of diffraction from lattice points. What happens because of the basis, that has to be accounted separately. Okay, that we do later. This condition is only for the diffractions to take place from the lattice points. I assume that diffraction is taking place only from that particular point, though atom may be much bigger there. All right. Now, as I said, if X-ray beam is incident, I can draw different set of planes. If I have put my crystal like that and X-ray beam is incident, then angle theta on all the set of planes are defined. Okay, for this set of planes, this is a theta. For another set, there is another theta. In fact, I have given a picture like this. See, if for example, X-ray beam is incident like this, okay, on this set of planes, this is my theta. On this set of planes, this is my theta. Okay, on this set of planes, this is my theta. So you can see there are three different theta. This set of planes, this is my theta. For this set of planes, this is my theta. For this set of planes, this is my theta. All three thetas are different. So once I have mounted my crystal and have allowed X-ray to be incident, then on all different planes, thetas are now fixed. Okay, and they are all different. All right. Now, in case I get a Bragg diffraction, then for at least one of the plane, 2d sin theta is equal to l lambda has to be satisfied. Then only I'll get Bragg reflection. Let us suppose for this set of planes, 2d sin theta is equal to l lambda is satisfied. Then the transmitted beam, or rather diffracted beam, will go like this, making same angle as this. Then it may not satisfy from any other plane, may or may not. Okay, if it satisfy, it gets satisfied for example, this set of planes, then diffracted beam will go in this particular direction, making this angle equal to that angle. Okay, so depending upon from which plane it gets satisfied, with that set of planes, angle of incidence must be equal to angle of reflection. Thetas are all fixed once I have frozen my single crystals. All right. So this is what I said. If everything is fixed, chances that 2d sin theta is equal to lambda will get satisfied for any set of planes are very little. So if you just take a single crystal and put X-ray on that particular thing, chances are that you may not get any Bragg reflection. Because thetas for all the sets are fixed, and at least for one set, you must satisfy 2d sin theta is equal to lambda. Okay, these are all discrete values. Theta is not continuously varying. Depending upon what are your planes, theta is discrete values, is acquiring discrete values. Okay, lambda is fixed, I am using a monochromatic beam. Okay, there is no way that, I mean, there is good chance that you will not get any Bragg diffraction. So in any experiment that we perform, generally one of the variables is continuous. So there is a standard, what we used to call Lovice pattern, okay, in which we are not using monochromatic source, but we are using a continuous source of X-rays. So lambda was not fixed. So at least for one particular lambda, Bragg reflection condition may get satisfied because there are multiple lambdas now. There is a lambda is continuously varying. Or you rotate the crystal. You don't keep the crystal in a fixed position, but keep on rotating the crystal. Okay, then at one particular angle for some set of planes, you will get Bragg reflection condition satisfied. Yeah.
That Bragg's law,
yeah.
In that diffraction of X-rays from the crystal, that how we are understanding in terms of interference, there is some term in there.
No, no. So basically, I mean, well, it's generally called diffraction and not really interference, but it's essentially the same thing. But see, let me put it like that. You know, I have not come to the derivation of 2D sensitized crystal lambda. If you take a beam and which is coming only on one of the planes, then you can show that the path difference must be equal to the n lambda, then only this condition will be satisfied. Then only you will be getting a constructive interference. All right? Now, for one set of planes, it is possible only when angle of incidence is equal to angle of reflection. If there was only one plane. Now, if you take one plane and another plane, which is kept at a distance d apart, then if this particular beam has to constructively interfere with the beam which is coming from the plane which is below it, then 2D sin theta is equal to n lambda should also be satisfied. Okay, so what we are deriving as basically the same interference condition, okay, which generally we call as a diffraction condition. They are essentially exactly identical, but this basically depends on how we derive our formula for the Bragg reflection. So first we take into case of only one particular plane and say that for that to have a constructive interference, I must have specular reflection condition satisfied. Then I take another set of parallel planes in that if the beam coming from this plane and the plane which is below it must constructively interfere, then you must have 2D sin theta is equal to n lambda also satisfied. Yeah.
My question is, if a student asks, how to distinguish between specular reflection and diffraction?
See, the thing is that it's always a Bragg diffraction, but no, we use it, this is a misnomer, we call it reflection. I mean, if you want to be exactly correct, this is always X-ray diffraction. Because, as I say, a normal reflection would mean that you will always get reflected light. I mean, this is one of the very famous quiz questions which people used to ask, what is the difference between a reflection and a Bragg reflection?
No, actually, in crystal is a 3D grating.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, in grating, you can get
Let me put it like that. This is the way Bragg looked into it. There are other ways of looking into it also. But you are right. 3D grating was the way Bragg looked at it. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and there is always a central maxima.
Yeah.
Okay, so central maxima is not due to diffraction.
See, the thing, yeah, okay.
So how can I then, because the problem is the incident beam.
No, central maxima, when you are talking about single slit reflection, diffraction.
No.
Here you have multiple points which are diffracting.
Look, the grating is acting as a reflecting grating.
Yeah.
The crystal is acting as reflection grating.
Yeah.
So in reflection grating also, you always get a central maxima and then the diffracted maximas.
Yeah.
So here, the incident beam and the detector, they are placed at the same angle. So basically, we are getting the...
No, see, you can also get second order diffraction because n becomes 2. See, you also get a second order diffraction and n can become 2. See, when you are saying 2, yes, there is central maximum and there is another maximum. What is the difference between them? This is the central maximum. Okay, for that n value has become different. Here also you can have the same thing because you can have n is equal to 2, you can have n is equal to 3.
But we measure mainly n equal to 1.
No, that's one thing which I would also like to mention. You are right, 100% right. The thing is that, for example, okay, this is a good question. Let me try to answer it, unfortunately. Let me come to that. Let me just explain this particular point a little bit. See, normally in Miller indices, there is no common factor. There is nothing like 2-0-0 plane. There is nothing like 2-2-2 plane. We will always call it 1-1-1 plane or 1-0-0 plane. Now, because of some convenience, which is a little difficult, in fact, that becomes more obvious when I will talk about the Lovis condition, which I want to talk. Okay, when you want to look at the parallelism between Lovis condition, which we feel from the solid state physics point of view is much more fundamental, okay, rather than the Bragg condition, though every crystallographer uses Bragg's condition. Okay, there, you know, when we draw parallelism, what we say, a second order reflection from 1-0-0, we call as a reflection from 2-0-0. No, replace reflection by diffraction. Okay, second order diffraction from 1-0-0 plane will be called diffraction from 2-0-0 plane. So if you look at X-ray diagram, X-ray crystallography, you will sign reflection or diffraction from 2-2-2 plane or 2-2-0 plane. Actually, these are actually diffractions from 111 plane or 110 plane. A second order diffraction from 111 plane in crystallography will be referred as a diffraction from 222 plane. A second order diffraction from 110 plane is referred as a diffraction from 220 plane. A third order diffraction from 110 plane will be referred as 330 diffraction. So it's very, very clear. If you look at, I mean, in fact, I will give you some of the examples. In fact, I'm planning to solve one particular example also. So if you look at that particular thing, things are very clear. You will always find diffraction coming from 220 plane. Now a student can always ask, you know, 220, what you always said that there cannot be a common factor in Miller indices. Okay, 220, there is nothing like 220, has to be only 110. Now a second order diffraction from 110 we call as 220. Because if you look at the D expression, everything will turn out to be exactly identical. Okay, so that's the reason there is a confusion about this particular thing. Otherwise, there is always a second order diffraction if present. Okay, if the space group does not reject it. Okay, there are always a possibility of third order diffraction and a third order diffraction. So, I mean, as you are talking, other diffraction, you know, things are present. Okay? Of course, intensities is a different question because intensities depend on so many other factors. Because remember, here we are talking only of diffraction from lattice points. Actual diffraction takes place from the atom which is there. And especially if you are talking of X-rays, okay, X-rays actually get diffracted from electrons. And depending upon the electron wave function, electrons could be anywhere in the unit cell. Okay, and diffraction could take place from any of them. And in principle, all of them have to be accounted before we can understand X-ray diffraction well. So Bragg diffraction only talks of diffraction from lattice points. All right, which takes care of only translational symmetry. It does not take care of basis. Okay, now there is a modern XRD machine. XRD machine is, let me put it like this. So you mount crystal in a particular plane. Now, you always take this particular plane as a reference. So you're always looking at the top frame. So what you do, you have X-ray beam which is incident, which is like this. You rotate this plane by theta. And you rotate detector by 2 theta. So that the Bragg diffraction condition, specular reflection condition is satisfied only for this particular plane. So you continuously keep on varying this particular thing, slowly and slowly. And your detector keeps on moving by an angle of 2 theta. So specular reflection condition always gets satisfied for this particular plane. Now, for some value of theta, whatever are the planes which are parallel to each, for that, a Bragg diffraction condition will get satisfied. Then at that particular value of theta, you will get a Bragg diffraction. So you will get a diffracted intensities. So generally, this is what is called theta 2 theta plot. Now, almost everyone does this thing. Now, we have X-ray machine in our department. I mean, we have multiple X-ray machines. So if some of you are interested, you can always look into that. Okay, so this is what I was trying to tell you. Now, next we talk is the effect of basis. X-rays are generally scattered by electrons within the atom. Now, when we take the effect of basis, there are two things which we account. Okay? But this is a little more complicated calculation which I am not doing. If you want to look at this, any book like Kittel's book, you know, they have derived all these things. Okay? So, for example, I may be putting multiple atom bases on a given lattice point. Okay? So, there is something like geometry of these particular points. Okay, how these particular atoms are put on the lattice point. For example, let's say I have set for diamond. Diamond is FCC lattice with two atoms basis. One atom is being put at origin. Another atom is being put at A by 4 I plus J plus K, which is 1/4 the distance of the body diagonal here, which forms the small cube's center. Okay, so this is geometry. I have put one point here, one atom there, one atom here. Another is how, if I put one atom here, how the electrons are distributed around the center of the atom. Okay? That depends on the wave functions. That's a much more complex problem because you have to know what are the wave functions, what are the probability of electron having at a one particular point, and then take diffraction from those particular points. Okay? So there are two factors which we separated out. One factor which we call as atomic form factor, which essentially tells that if I had just one atom, how the X-ray will get diffracted from different points of the atom if I know the wave functions, if I know the probability of electron being found there. For that, you have to know quantum mechanics, you should be able to solve the wave function. It's a much more difficult problem. Another problem is purely the geometrical problem, how atoms are put around a particular lattice point. How the centers of the atoms are put around a particular lattice point. So first thing, which is atomic form factor, takes care of the electron distribution within an atom. So take the center of the atom, how the electrons are distributed around that, and what we call as a structure factor takes care of the geometrical distribution of the atoms within a basis. How the centers of the atoms are distributed geometrically around a lattice point. Now, if you take a cubic lattice, cubic structure, and generally express this in terms of a simple cubic lattice. That's what we do. So we consider a BCC lattice also as a simple cubic lattice with two atoms basis, FCC lattice as also a simple cubic lattice with four atoms basis. Then the structure factor tells, this is a rather simple calculation, but you know, it will take a little longer time, so I'm not doing it. You can look into Kittel's book. You'll find that if the lattice is simple cubic, all the reflections will be present. All the diffractions from all the planes will be allowed. But if it happens to be a body-centered cubic, all those diffractions for which h plus k plus l is odd would be missing. Okay? Because you'll find that because the geometry of this particular thing, this particular atom here and this particular atom will constructively, they will interfere destructively if h plus k plus l was odd. It's rather simple to show. Okay? But basically the thing is that h plus k plus l, which are odd, okay, will not be present in a BCC structure. So it means a reflection from 100 plane, because h is 1, k is 0, l is 0, so h plus k plus l is 1, which is odd, okay, will not be present. A diffraction 110 would be present because h plus k plus l is 1 plus 1 plus 0, 2. So that will be present. 111 will not be present because 1 plus 1 plus 1 becomes odd, which is 3, which will not be present. Now, if it is FCC lattice, then the formula is somewhat different. Okay? It means all individually h, k, l should be either even or all should be odd. 0 is always taken as even. So if I take 100 reflection, 1 is odd, 0 is even, 0 is even, this will not be present. Take 110, 1 is odd, 0 is even, it will not be present. Okay? If you take 200, 2 is even, 0 is even, 0 is even, which is present. Remember, 200 is second order reflection from 100. So second order diffraction from 110 will be present, but original diffraction n is equal to 1 will not be present. For cubic lattices, you can show that the distance between the planes is given by this, a upon under root h square plus k square plus l square. And you put this in 2d sin theta is equal to n lambda, you find that sin square theta will be proportional to h square plus k square plus l square. I'll just give one example how to index this particular photograph for a cubic lattice, then we'll go about it. So this is what I have done for certain number of set of planes. So, for example, if you take 100, n is h square plus k square plus l square, that's what I have written as n. So, this h square plus k square plus l square I have written as n. If you take n 1, it means this refers to 100 plane because 1 square plus 0 square plus 0 square is 1. Okay, so this will be allowed only in simple cubic. Okay, if you take 110, this will be allowed in simple cubic and BCC. If it is FCC, only 111 will be allowed in simple cubic as well as in FCC. 200 will be allowed in all three of them. 5 will be allowed only in simple cubic. 7 cannot be represented as sum of 3 squares, so 7 will never be present. So you can see, in fact, the older time, you know, this is signature of FCC lattice, two very close lines separated by two close lines. In fact, in the olden time, people will just look and say this is FCC. Yes. So hexagonal also you have exactly, and I have not given the expression, but I can give you the expression. This D expression will become somewhat different. All right, and remember, normal hexagonal, the most common structure is what is called hexagonal close pack structure, which is actually not forming a Bravias lattice. Okay, hexagonal close pack is actually hexagonal lattice with two atom spaces. Okay, there also you will find certain reflections present. But if you look any standard books, you get a Colitti's book on X-ray diffraction, but there are many, many standard books on X-ray diffraction. They will all talk about all these sort of particular planes. All right, so this is just a table which is generally useful. Now, this is one particular value of, just an example, where I have given the theta values for various diffractions that you have seen through a particular crystal, that you have seen diffractions at these particular values of thetas. Then you take sine square thetas of these things and then you try to match. Then you realize that if it is FCC, then the ratio of the first two lines should be 3/4. Okay, so if you look here, this ratio turns out to be actually 3/4, this particular ratio. So you can identify that this is actually a FCC lattice. Then you just index that these particular thetas are coming from these set of planes. So this is just a typical example of how we index the photograph. Now, utility of XRD, it's a powerful technique, can be used to obtain many information in presence of various phases. And in fact, this is one of the things, I being essentially a condensed matter physicist and more of material scientist, but first thing that our students will do when they'll prepare the material, do an XRD to see whether you have really formed the material that you're interested in. You expect your material to have a particular crystal structure, whether it's having that crystal structure or there's some impurity which has mixed it, some other crystal structure has mixed it. So this is the most common thing that we do, presence of various phases and their relative concentration. We also look at texture and orientation, because if you have polycrystalline material, all the crystallites may be oriented in a particular fashion, alignment of a single crystal, and of course obtaining lattice constants. These are typical diffraction patterns that you get, you know, these are the what we call as theta 2 theta. Remember, this is always given as a function of 2 theta, because detector always moves at an angle of 2 theta, and these are the different peaks that you get. And here, for example, it's a mixture of two materials, so you can see that these peaks get split, and you can see that this is a mixture of, I mean, this is data taken by one of my students, zinc ferrite and cobalt ferrite. They have small difference in lattice constant, and you can clearly see that both the phases are present together. Now let me define reciprocal lattice, because that's what we had discussed about last time. See, as we have just now discussed, that a lattice can be defined using a set of primitive vectors. So if I know primitive vectors of a direct lattice, I can define primitive vectors of a reciprocal lattice. And as the name suggests, reciprocal lattice, the dimensions that I am talking are of inverse of length. Okay? But we can always imagine things. I mean, I always tell the students, see, in graph paper, we do not always plot things which are only of dimension of position. Okay, if you take simple pendulum, you plot a graph between t square and whatever it is. So you take an appropriate scale that, you know, 1 centimeter will be equal to that much value of t square. Okay, similarly, we can always imagine a lattice which does not have a dimension of length, but has the dimension of inverse of length by taking an appropriate scale. So you can always say that 1 millimeter will be equal to 1 angstrom inverse. Okay, and then imagine this particular lattice in 3 dimension. So we have ABC vectors, which are the vectors, primitive vectors of a direct lattice. Then I can find out the primitive vectors of reciprocal lattice using these particular things. I would just like to mention that, you know, this factor of 2 pi is only a recent introduction, not recent, it's quite old, almost from the time when I was a student. But if you look at very, very old books like Azarov, okay, then this 2 pi factor was not there earlier. So, but doesn't matter, because the earlier things that they were deriving had a 2 pi factor. But it's like that, you know, when MKS units started, initially there was just a constant, then we started putting 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught. So this 4 pi was put so that all other equations become a little more easier. So that's the way it happened. So this 2 pi factor now is generally believed. So if you're talking of A, you must have B cross C. If you're talking of B, you must have C cross A. If you have C, you must have A cross B. Of course, denominator is commoner, A dot B cross C. Okay, this is the way you define the reciprocal of a direct lattice. If you take a simple cubic lattice, I have already given you what are the primitive vectors of simple cubic lattice. You can show that, just use those particular definitions, you'll find that capital A will turn out to be 2 pi by A I, capital B will turn out to be 2 pi by A B, and capital C will turn out to be 2 pi by A K. So this also happens to be simple cubic lattice, because all the 3 dimensions are same, okay, but with a lattice constant of 2 pi by A. Because A is of dimension of length, so as I have mentioned to you, reciprocal lattice is always of the dimension inverse of length. Similarly, you can always find out the reciprocal lattice of a body-centered cubic, and then you will find capital A to be like this. And this happens to be a face-centered cubic lattice, because remember, face-centered cubic was the one in which you had A, J plus K. And remember, in face-centered cubic lattice, we had A by 2, J plus K. So a reciprocal lattice of a body-centered cubic lattice turns out to be a face-centered cubic lattice of lattice constant 4 pi by A, not 2 pi by A. In simple cubic, it's 2 pi by A. In face-centered cubic, in body-centered cubic, it's 4 pi by A. Similarly, you can show that for a face-centered cubic lattice, the reciprocal lattice turns out to be a body-centered cubic lattice of lattice constant 4 pi by A. Just use those particular definitions. There is no other way of doing it. Now, there are certain properties of these particular lattices, sorry, I'm going a little faster, which shows that A dot A is equal to 2 pi by 2 pi, which is very easy to show, because if you go even to this particular definitions, if you take A dot A, then you have A dot B cross C, this will cancel it, so A dot A will be equal to 2 pi. But on the other hand, if you take A dot B, you remember B cross C numerator will give you a vector which is both perpendicular to B and C. So if you take B dot of that particular vector, okay, the cos theta will be 90, it will be 0. So these are the typical equations that A dot A is 2 pi, B dot B is 2 pi, C dot C is 2 pi, all other dot products become 0. That's the reason it's called reciprocal, because A, in fact, if we do not have 2 pi factor, A dot A will just be equal to 1. So this appears to be almost perpendicular to each other. Now, one thing which is very interesting, I'm rather really running out of time. So we can always define a translation vector in a direct lattice, which we had just now defined when we were trying to talk of Bravias lattice, T as n1a plus n2b plus n3c. Similarly, we can define a translation vector in a reciprocal lattice, which is given as g is equal to, let's say, another constant m1a plus m2b plus m3c. Now you can show that g dot t, because of the property that I have just now mentioned, if I take a dot a, I'll give 2 pi. If I take b dot b, I'll get 2 pi. If I get c dot c, I'll get 2 pi. A dot b will be 0, a dot c will be 0, b dot a will be 0, b dot c dot c will be 0. Okay. If you just take g dot t, this will become this particular thing. And because all those numbers in the bracket are integers, so essentially it will be equal to 2 pi times some integer. Therefore, e raised to power I g dot t will be e raised to power 2 pi m, which is cos 2m pi plus sin 2m pi, which will give you 1. So e raised to power I g dot t turns out to be equal to 1. Now, this is one thing which I wanted to go through, because this for solid state physics is much more important. See, there is another condition of diffraction which was derived by Loy, which is a totally different way of looking into it. Okay, in Bravias lattice, I generally call it in Bragg's condition, it was a top down. You had lattice and then you started dividing into planes. While Loy's condition, you start with two points, then generate lattice. So it's bottom up. So you first find out diffraction condition from two points. Okay, then replace these two points by lattice. So we consider a lattice, consider any two arbitrary points of a lattice. Let the incident wave vector be k in the direction n. Let the outgoing wave vector be k prime in the direction of n. I want to find a condition that a beam will really go in k prime direction. What is the condition for that? I get a diffracted beam in k prime direction if I have only two points. Okay, so this is what I have said, that let's suppose this is my two points which are separated by a position vector d, and this is the way my x-ray is coming. So this is my wave vector k. Okay, I want to find out what is the condition that my x-ray diffraction goes out in this particular k prime direction. This is my incident beam, this is my d, these are my k primes. I want to find out the condition only from two points. All right, so I put these angles. So let's suppose this angle is theta, this angle is phi. Okay, I find what is the path difference. That's what we do. So the path difference, this particular point, this particular ray travels this distance and this distance extra. All right, this distance, as you can see, is d. If I take the magnitude, this as d, is d cos theta plus d cos phi. Theta and phi are generally arbitrary. Okay, so this is my path difference, d cos theta plus d cos phi. Now I generate my unit vectors. So this is my n vectors, this is my n prime, because n is a unit vector in the direction of k, n prime is a unit direction in the direction k prime, and so this particular direction will be minus n prime. So this path difference can be written as d dot n plus d dot minus n, because n is a unit vector. So this will give me d cos theta or d cos phi. Now condition for constructive interference is that this path difference should be equal to m lambda, standard diffraction condition. So this should be equal to m lambda, which means that d dot k minus k prime should be equal to 2 pi by m into 2 pi m, which implies that e raised to power I d dot k minus k prime should be equal to 1. So diffraction condition from these two points is that if this happens to be equal to 1, then I will get a constructive interference in k prime direction. Now remember, this is being talked only for two arbitrary points of a lattice. Now if I really get a k prime, in k prime direction, a diffracted condition, diffracted beam, then not only from these two points, but you take any two pairs of the lattice, this condition must get satisfied. All right, not only for these two points, but you take any two pairs, any two atoms, any two points, not atoms, but any two points, this condition must get satisfied. It means this condition should get satisfied if d is replaced by any translation vector of a direct lattice. Okay, because two points of a lattice is always connected by a translation vector t, which is m1a plus m2b plus m3c. So in principle, this condition should get satisfied if d is replaced by any translation vector t. This condition must be satisfied for any general translation vector of the direct lattice. Hence, we must have e raised to power I t dot minus k, dot k minus k prime is equal to 1. And just now we said that this condition is satisfied if we have e raised to power I t dot g equal to 1. It always is equal to 1. It means you must have k minus k prime should be equal to G. So this is what is the called the Lovitz condition, that change in the wave vector of the X-rays must be equal to a reciprocal lattice vector. This condition is actually a little more fundamental for solid state physicists. I will tell you the reasons why this is considered much more fundamental, because this generally refers to what we call as a conservation of crystal momentum, okay, which is a very, very important condition for solid state physicists. So this is just a precursor of that particular condition. Of course, it can be shown that these two conditions, Lovitz condition and the Bragg's condition, are equivalent. Here we talk of reciprocal lattice vectors and not lattice planes. In Bravias condition, we're always talking of lattice planes. Here, the same are being replaced by G. So a particular diffraction is coming. What is the G involved? What is the reciprocal lattice vector which is involved there? So we always talk in terms of G. And as I said, this is a special form of conservation of crystal momentum. Of course, in this case, H cross K actually turns out to be momentum. But last time I had talked a little bit about crystal momentum. There is a general law of conservation of crystal momentum. Remember, conservation of crystal momentum may not get completely conserved. There is always a possibility of addition of a reciprocal lattice vector. Anyway, that other fast. I take a corollary of this particular thing. See, in all the X-ray diffraction, we assume that the wavelength of light does not change after diffraction. So in fact, this is called elastic scattering. There is also a possibility that X-ray may get scattered inelastically, where part of the energy of the photon is used for some other processes. Okay, but in X-ray diffraction, we are only looking at what we call as elastic scattering, that magnitude of K and magnitude of K prime are same. So initial lambda and then final lambdas are same. So if you just put this particular equation, Bragg's condition, in a slightly different form, just square these things, it means take dot product of this particular thing with its own, then this condition can be obtained. Just square this will become K. I have taken this and put this on the other side, taken K prime on the other side. So you will become K prime square is equal to K square plus G square minus 2 K dot G. Because the magnitude of this and this is same, so this I can cancel it out. So it becomes K dot G is equal to half times G, okay? Which actually means if I take a unit vector along the direction of a reciprocal lattice, this is K dot G is equal to half G. This is another way of looking into what we call as the Lovitz condition. Now, this particular condition can be used to construct one of the very important things which is called Bravias zones. So that's what I will discuss now. So let us suppose we have a two-dimensional lattice. And of course, you can imagine this to be a three-dimensional lattice. Nothing will change. Okay, remember the condition was K dot G is equal to half G. All right. Now let's take one particular point of this particular lattice as origin. Yes.
Regarding this XRD, yeah. In this structure.
Yeah.
So suppose if I have a
nanomaterial and then in a powdered form, if I take the XRD, so basically through that peak 2 theta, by knowing that theta, you can calculate capital D, which is written as a crystallite size. So
that's a different thing. Okay, crystallite size is different. Okay, you complete your question.
So there. Just I want to know, sir, the basic difference between that crystallized size, particle size, and the grain size. So these three are a bit.
Okay. Okay, let me first explain this particular thing before I go to the. See, the thing is that as far as I am concerned, crystallite size is same as grain size. There's something which is called particle size. Okay, which according to me is different. See, you have powdered your sample. Okay, if you have powdered your sample, if you take one grain, one small part, piece of that particular particle, okay, this may not be a single crystal. Depends again on the size. Okay, if the size is very big, or rather comparatively big, you may find that in this particular small particle also, there may be multiple grains. When we talk of generally grains, it means different type of single crystals. So what is a polycrystalline material? A polycrystalline material is actually consists of a very large number of crystalline materials, and these crystals are rotated randomly with respect to each other. So if you take this particular material, this particular end may be a small crystal, this may be another small crystal, but this crystal and this crystal are rotated with respect to each other in a random fashion. So this is what we call as a polycrystal. Now generally in material science, we call this a single crystallite, whatever is that, we call as a grain. Okay, so generally it's confused because we are talking about a powder sample, because powder also we call it grain. But this particular powder, one small piece of powder, may still consist of multiple grains, because within this there may be multiple single crystals which are oriented with respect to each other. Okay, so this is what we call as grain. Now, in X-ray we do use it to find out the grain size, because remember, okay, this is by a formula which is generally called a Scherer formula. Almost all of our students use it. Okay, the thing is that if we have really an infinite crystal, if we really have an infinite crystal, in that particular case, you can show that other than the natural line width of your X-rays, there will be no other width of the X-rays. But for example, if I am talking only two planes, now if I am talking only two planes, you may not get completely destructive interference for all values of theta. So you find that as the grain size keeps on going down, it means your crystal is no longer that infinite. You will find that the width that you are getting becomes broadened. So this width which I have been showing here, if you are looking at this particular width, okay, you see there always finite width. There is always a finite width. Okay, it's not very sharp. If you take a single, if you take a material with a large grain or a single crystal material, you will find this extremely sharp. Okay, now Scherer has given a formula which correlates this width to the what we call as a grain size. So what people do, take this particular width and from that they calculate what is approximately the grain size, which gives you only an approximate value. Let's be very, very clear. In fact, we normally ask the students to do this particular experiment and say that, you know, you verify from some other method. There are certain other methods like, you know, electron microscopes from which you can get much clearer idea of the grain sizes. Okay?
The grain size is equal to the crystallized size.
Yeah, yeah. See, generally, I mean, in material science, grain size and crystallized size are, you know, replaces one another. But when you are saying the particle size, that's generally different. See, if you are taking a powder sample and you are taking a particle, that particle size may be different.
And also, it is valid for 100 nanometers.
Beg your pardon?
100 nanometer thickness.
Generally, Scherer formula is not applicable beyond 100 nanometers. So, if your thickness, grain sizes are less than 100 nanometers, then only most of the time your Scherer formula will work. And I mean, generally, I say I never like to bet on the grain size evaluated from Scherer formula. If you are looking at a trend, I will believe it. If you are measuring, preparing samples by different techniques, and then you are finding out that, you know, Scherer formula is giving you different values, okay, the trend, I will agree. But if somebody calculates and says that I have found 25 nanometers, and I, you know, if you want me to bet that it's only 25 and not 26, I will not agree. Because, you know, it's giving you a very, very average behavior of the grain size, okay? You're not really watching the grain size. If you, I mean, the best method to calculate the grain size is you do a dark field imaging in the transmission electron microscope. That's the one which gives you most correct. But it has also its own limitation. To make a sample for transmission electron microscope is a hell of a job. I mean, you ask our PhD students, you know, they essentially cry when you have to make some samples for them because the electron beam has to get transmitted. So the material has to be so thin, especially if you are talking of thin films where there is substrate behind it. Okay. Then also you are watching a very, very small area. Now if your film or material is non-uniform, okay, just counting those some 30 or 40 grains, you know, may not be actual representation of the grain size. So each method has its own limitation. And then one has to adopt a proper method in research. Okay, so we said, let's suppose we take one particular point and origin, and let's take another, and let's suppose this is a reciprocal lattice, let me put it like that. See, let's suppose this is a reciprocal lattice, not the direct lattice. Remember, wave vector also has a dimension of 2 pi by lambda. So this is also of inverse of length, so a wave vector can be drawn without any other approximation in this particular reciprocal lattice space. So let us suppose we draw a wave vector starting from this particular point. Okay, what I insist, let's suppose this is another reciprocal lattice vector. Okay, so if I join this particular point to this particular point, this is one of the G's. Okay, now let us draw a plane which is bisecting this line, this vector G, to which G is normal. So this is what I'm drawing. All right, now what I'm insisting that if a wave vector ends anywhere on this particular point, then K dot G, G is this. This is one of the, at the moment I am looking at only one point of the lattice. Okay, I'll keep on looking at other points. So I am looking, this is my origin, this is another point of the reciprocal lattice, this is one of the valid G. I took one particular plane in three dimension, a line in two dimension, which divides this particular G into half. If my K starts from here to here, then K dot G will be just this particular distance. If this happens to be just ending on this particular line, then K dot G will be equal to half G. It means if I draw a wave vector from here to any other point, this particular plane, if it ends, if the tip just ends at that particular point, then this particular K will satisfy a condition of Bragg diffraction. Okay, so this is my K and this is my G. If this just ends at the tip, K dot G, remember unit vector, will be this particular distance. This will be just equal to half G. This is what is that particular condition, then I will get Bragg diffraction. It means if I draw this particular plane in three dimension and start my K wave vector from origin, if the tip of this particular vector ends any point on this particular plane, then this particular value of this particular k, this particular x-ray will get Bragg diffraction. In which direction? You can always find out from k minus k prime equal to g. You just take the vector difference, you'll find out what is the k prime direction. All right? Now, I have taken only one of the directions. Now, I must take all the other points also. Okay? So, now I move. This was only from one point. Let's suppose I go to this particular point. If I have to go to this particular point, then I must join this particular point and draw a perpendicular bisector or a normal bisector. So this is what I have to do. Now, if a wave vector ends here, then this will suffer a Bragg diffraction from this particular g. If it ends here, it will suffer two Bragg diffraction, one from this particular g, another from this particular g. Okay? Now, I keep on drawing. Now, I have taken this as nearest neighbor. I keep on further drawing, I have taken this particular nearest neighbor. I have taken, I mean, just in two dimension, I have taken only nearest neighbor in two dimension. Then I must talk of next nearest neighbor. So I must look at these particular points. This particular point, this is the next nearest neighbor. So you draw this particular line. Then you draw this particular line. Okay? You draw this particular line. You draw this particular line. Keep on going to next nearest neighbor. You draw this particular point. You have gone to a point which is much above. Now, if you keep on drawing, eventually you find the whole, you have a mesh of lines, you know, here, there, here, there. And if you start a value of k, okay, from the origin, if tip of this particular k ends on any of these particular lines, okay, then it will suffer a Bragg diffraction. Now, in order to simplify these issues, this particular complicated figure, which happens in two dimensions, is fairly complicated, three dimensions becomes more complicated, okay, we divide into certain zones, which are called Brillouin zones. So this is what is the definition of a Brillouin zone. A volume in a reciprocal lattice space is called nth Brillouin zone if all the points within it, except of course boundaries, if joined to the origin, cross exactly n minus 1 planes, no fewer, no longer. If the tip of the incident wave vector drawn from origin lands exactly on the surface of any Brillouin zone, it will suffer a diffraction. All right? So, this was the picture which I have drawn. Now, I will draw first Brillouin zone. So, you take this particular points. If you cross, if you join any point to the origin, this will not cross any of the planes, any of these lines. So, this is my first Brillouin zone. All right. Now, if I talk of second Brillouin zone, this will be these portions. When you draw to the origin, this will just cross one of the lines. This is my second Brillouin zone. All right, because take any particular point, you join to the origin, it just crosses line. If you take this particular point, it just crosses this only one line. If you take this particular point, it just crosses one line. This is my second Brillouin zone. This is my third Brillouin zone. If you take this particular point, joins to this particular point, it will cross this line, this line. Of course, you can look into the picture, textbook, you know, they have drawn multiple Brillouin zones. Importance of Brillouin zone, this actually concept of Brillouin zone is one of the most important fundamental concept of solid state physics. Concept of reciprocal lattice and concept of Brillouin zone, these are what you call as the bread and butter of solid state physicists. I mean, that's the first thing that people have to learn. Generally, we assign a wave vector for excitations like phonons, etc. In fact, that's one of the most important uses of Brillouin zone. In fact, you can show, I mean, I had talked about it yesterday, that wave vector, there is not a single unique way of representing the wave vector of electron of a block electron. Okay, in fact, the wave vector that you assign, you can always add to it a reciprocal lattice wave vector, and that will be as good as a wave vector as the original one. In fact, we get into one condition that almost all the excitations, their wave vector can always be represented only in the first Brillouin zone. So that's why Brillouin zone becomes very, very important, because all the k values which are confined into one Brillouin zone, they are generally are the most important. Even the band structures, they are just expressed in just one first Brillouin zone. So I think I have just ended. I'd like to just mention you before we leave that this is one model which I have brought, which is got for a Brillouin zone for a FCC lattice. So remember, reciprocal of FCC lattice is a BCC lattice. So if you look at these particular points, okay, and there is a point at the center which you can probably see inside it. Okay. So now you take this particular point at the center, you go to the nearest neighbor, which is this nearest neighbor, body centered cubic. These two are the nearest atoms. So you draw, and this is a plane which bisects it. So for example, this particular plane which bisects it. Take at a particular point, it has eight nearest neighbors in body-centered cubic. Remember, this is FCC lattice, but the reciprocal is BCC. And I have to draw these Brillouin zones in the reciprocal lattice space, not in the direct lattice space. Okay, so this is for FCC, reciprocal of which is BCC. Okay, now you have eight corners, eight these things. So you will have 8 of these corners. So this will be octahedron. Okay, this, there is a small mistake here in this particular thing, because this side should be equal to this side. This has not been drawn very correctly, but let's just accept it. Okay. Now you go to the second nearest neighbor. Second nearest neighbor is distance A here. Okay. So you draw a plane like this. Okay, which bisects it. So this gets truncated. So this is called truncated octahedron. This is actually the first Bloom zone of a FCC lattice. Okay. Now you can see the shape is fairly complex. If you have to express your band structure for FCC solid, okay, if you express, let's say, along 100 direction, you have to go along this particular direction. Then the time when you are going to hit Bloom zone boundary is going to be different. If you are going along 111 direction, this is the way you are going to hit the zone boundary. So it basically depends on which direction you are using. But important fact is that essentially is the first Bloom zone. All the K values which are confined into first Bloom zone, they are generally of the physical significance. All the K values can be translated back to the first Bloom zone. I think I'll end here. I took a lot of your time. Thank you.